You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. And yes, if you are watching chronologically, this is the second interview in the same day because I'm wearing the same t-shirt. On this particular episode, I am joined by the pretty boy of Fair City Wrestling, the current king of the class, which we'll talk about a little bit later on. It's Sam McMillan. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
I'm glad to have you on. It's you've been a guest that's been requested quite a few times, mainly by Patrick Petersky.
I was going to say, I assumed it would be.
He's sent me a list every so often. Every time I put the thing on going, who do you want to see on the podcast? He sends me a list of guys, and your name's always pretty much at the top of it.
Funnily enough, when you put out the thing saying for the vacancies, it was him that sent me it.
Ah, right. Well, there you go. He loves FCW. What can I say?
He does.
Even if he calls the Dundee and Angus Pro Wrestling Academy the worst name in the world, he loves it, clearly. So we should have more Fair City Wrestling stuff in the coming months, coming weeks, depending on if I don't have a breakdown with how many I've scheduled in the next few weeks. But this isn't about them, this is about you. So I said off recording, I'm just going to let you just relax and tangent away, and that's what I like to do on this podcast anyway. All right. But we start with the icebreaker, the most cliched question in all of podcasting, all of wrestling podcasting, a question you've probably already answered on the FCW podcast that you should also check out on the network for those that haven't. How did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment that you watched it or got into it that made you a fan?
See, there might actually be two. I don't remember the first one because it was something that I was always into as a child. Never really watched it, but had action figures and a ring that I'd play with my brother. And then it's obviously the games on the PS2 and whatever. But I fell out of it at some point. I don't remember when. But then one day we had, I think it was WWE 2K15. And after years of not playing it, I decided, you know what, I'll jump back on this because it's been a while. And it was ever since that I then went and bought, I think at that point there was 2K16, 2K17 out, got them, played more of them, and just it became something I was interested in long term after that. So started actually watching it. I think the first show I properly watched was WrestleMania 2018. Which had probably a great opening match to get someone back into wrestling, the IC title triple threat, Miz, Finn Balor, Seth Rollins.
That was a fantastic opener.
Yeah, definitely, at least got me hooked on Finn Balor and Seth Rollins anyway. But yeah, from there it's just been watch it when I can nowadays. Because it was something I saw on Spike's episode, that he said since he started, he watches less and less. That's something that I've noticed as well. But it's also, we're in the UK, so staying up till 1 a.m. to watch a show, it's a difficult thing.
Especially if you're wanting to try and get up and do training the next day and trying to improve your own craft as well. But I'll get back to that and find out about your favourites, what have you. But the thing that piqued my interest in that initial bit was the figures. Now, I want to be a figure guy, but I don't have the space in my house to be a figure guy. I've got Pops, but they take up a whole less room than figures.
Yeah. So
got my Drew there. Do you remember which ones you had? Do you remember the I always find that everyone's got the normal kind of your Jacks or your Mattel ones, and there's always a random one that's like a Hasbro or a WCW on or something like that. Do you remember what you had?
I think it was like the Jax ones back then. I think they actually belonged to mainly my brother because I don't remember ever getting them. Just sort of something that's ingrained in my memory. But yeah, it was, I think it was probably the Jax ones.
Right, cool. Yeah, it's just stemming from that chat I had with Andrew Cramen from Bleeding Gums, and he showed me, he somehow won for some reason, bought some figures, and just reminded me that my first ones were the bone breaking ones, which, to be honest, probably came out before you were born. So it's probably older than yourself. But yeah, it's just a fascinating thing. And I said to him, and I'll say to you as well, I'm a trading card guy now. It takes up a lot less room in the house.
Yeah.
I've got a little pocket with my wee trading cards in it for all my guests. So if SW want to put out a trading card line, I'll be first in line for a set. Anyway, right. So following on from that then. So you got back into it through the video games and then into watching the wrestling itself. And yeah, like I say, you're finding you're watching it less and less now because you're busy doing it.
Yeah.
As well, but when you first got back into it, Seth Rollins, Finn Balor, you mentioned, was there anyone else who kind of caught your eye that maybe put the thought in your mind of trying it yourself?
It was pretty much those two, and I want to say Dolph Ziggler are the three that stick out in my mind.
All right, so three guys that are lean, ripped, and throw themselves about. So that's kind of the Sam McMillan thing.
Yeah.
Kind of,
well,
from the footage I've seen of you anyway. So from that point, so we're talking 2018, right, 2024, so that's a 6-year gap. So you got back into wrestling. When did you decide that you were ready to pursue it yourself?
There was several points where I went, I want to do this. Like, the first one that I initially think of is after the first ever live wrestling show I've ever been to. It was local in Dundee in the Caird Hall. I think that says all it needs to say about what it was. But it was there and afterwards because I had someone, well, technically I had two people that I work beside outside of wrestling in there, so we're going along supporting them. And afterwards, I was like, I want to do this. And it was something I never ended up doing until I passed my driving test. So I was in college, just passed my driving test and went, what's stopping me at this point? So obviously decided I'll give it one session, see how it goes. And then that bug that hits us all happened, and I never stopped going back.
Right. So, Caird Hall. So, I don't need to mention who what the promotion is. That's But do you remember? Because usually I have a special guest on that show. Do you remember who they were?
I think I actually don't.
Was Grado on it?
No. See, it was a bit after that. I think the one I went to was 2019. Don't remember if there was.
A show so good it's not on Cage Match. So anyway, right, okay. So yeah. So you got into the local scene then, and that was your first ever one. So from that point onwards, were you aware before then there was a local scene like your ICWs?
Not really. Or anything? No, not really. Only once I found out about that was the opening point for more local stuff.
You saw what they did. You went, I can do this. If they can attack, I can. No, I mean they're all for slander, but I'll probably will end up getting a very snotty DM by that. So was there Fair City that you approached to start, or
yeah, which is really really strange considering I'm faith based. It would have made more sense in terms of travel to go to what is now Power Pro. But I'd already met the likes of Ian Ambrose and I knew that he was coaching there. So I thought, for me, I don't like really trying anything new unless I know there's someone that I know there. Right. Just a very anxious person. So it was more of, there's someone there I know, so I don't have to entirely go into something new with no one around me. So it was more for that.
That makes a lot of sense, world. So yeah, you have that familiarity of seeing Ian. So you're like, okay, cool, right. I know one person at least. And that. So have you approached to go to, have you done seminars and that at PowerPoint?
Not as of yet. Seminars always seem to happen when I'm on a break from training that I had a couple of years ago, or when I'm working or doing other work outside of it. So availability never seems to line up for stuff like that.
It's always the way, isn't it? It's the same with, with podcasts and stuff as well. It's like I tried to get guests on, and it's always the case of I've got someone on already, or I've got I'm going to a show or something like that, because and then it's like, do I bump someone for this, or do I skip work or anything like that? And I never do that. If anyone from my work's watching, I never skip work to do interviews. Not at all. Never. So yeah. So you started training then. Ian Ambrose being the person that's part of the training staff. Do you remember who else was in your class on that first couple of weeks?
I actually don't, because I can't remember. Like, well, first couple of weeks, I met the likes of Bochico, Sebastian Asher, and Tom Atlas. But other than that, I can't really think of any of the others off the top of my head.
So, I mean, those three that you picked out, or at least two of them, I don't know the entire backstory and history of Bochico. I don't think anyone does. But those two, Asher and Atlas, they would have had prior training as well. So they're coming into the DAPDUB with that prior training. Anyway, so they're coming with a little bit of a step up on you, whereas you're coming in absolutely fresh from nothing. So as well as having Ian there, were they kind of guys that you tried to maybe try to pick the brain of to maybe kind of push you on a little bit, or was that just a couple of weeks of anxious shuffling over to them and hoping to absorb something right by osmosis?
Not so much Bochco and Asher, but, well, not really Tom either. He more sort of adopted me into everything. I can't say enough nice things, because from the first moment he met me, it was like giving me advice after advice after advice, and then was always checking in on me, especially during, like I mentioned, I took a break like a couple of years ago after I just first started for a while because life took over. So Tom was constantly checking to make sure everything was all right, wondering when I was coming back. So it was mostly like Tom giving so much advice, and I'm so grateful.
So this is probably near 300 episodes, the first time someone has something positive to say about Tom Atlas, which
I have to give him his due. He can be a handful, but he has done a lot of good.
I like Tom. I hope he always knows it's a good sport. When
yeah.
Certainly is from this end. I don't know, when it comes to the day of birth bonanza, it gets a bit tense. it gets a bit tense on those. So I don't know if it's totally.
That was brutal to watch.
It's just fun, to be honest.
Yeah.
I think. Sorry, Tom. Sorry, Tom. But it's not your episode, so you know, back in the fish. So you started then your training and took your break. You said life took over. We don't need to get into that. So we're a positive space, unless you want to talk about it. But it's a positive space that we try to nurture here. When you returned, though, did you feel like you were ready for it then, or was that a case of now or never when you came back?
When I came back, I definitely felt like it was the right time. Was less burnt out, because mainly just burnout with college and the other, like my acting work that I do outside of college and wrestling. It was all bunching together. And it was sort of the decision of, well, something has to move to the side for now. So being that everything is more local to me, it was the wrestling that had to sort of just take its place aside. But when I came back, I felt pretty good about it, was excited to be back. And from there, it was just a case of getting in as much as I could and just trying to progress as much as possible and make up for lost time.
You mentioned acting then, we'll totally segue into that because I'm very curious about this. So has that always been something you've wanted to do? Is this pre-wrestling? Is acting
yes.
always a speed of interest?
Yes. It's funny because every time I tell a story about it, it's the same quote I use. I've never actually remembered a time where I've wanted to do anything else, like before wrestling. So it's like watching the TV when I was younger, it was always looking at actors and thinking, that's what I want to do. But funnily enough, like my primary school and that had a hopeless drama department. Like it was little to non-existent. Pardon me. And then I went to high school. I was like, maybe this will be better. In the first couple of years, my drama department in high school, there was like no teachers. So I don't know how this dream stayed alive through all of that, but I'm glad it did because it helps with wrestling as well.
Absolutely. Do you remember something on TV that made you want, when you saw an actor or a TV show in particular that made you go, yes, that's, I want to do what that guy's doing or that girl's doing. I want to be what they're doing.
David Tennant is the 10th Doctor in Doctor Who. It has to be.
Fair enough. I've just felt so old because I was old enough when that was happening. So Tennant, I mean, yeah, he's probably my doctor, to be honest. I never got into it when I was young. Well, it wasn't on when I was younger. I think it finished in 1997 and I was the Paul McGann?
Before it stopped, it would have been Sylvester McCoy, and then the TV movie was Paul McGann.
That's it, right? It's fine. I've just assumed you're Whovian, but because you're
yeah.
So it's, and then Eccleston came back. I was like, stay for me. But Tennant, yeah, that was my sweet spot of acting. Was it just, did it help because he was Scottish and like a bit of a thespian as well, or was it how he did it?
I think it was just overall everything worked towards me thinking, this is one of the coolest things ever, because in terms of acting, Doctor Who is like the best show you could want for an actor, because you get to live out so many things. So it's like, if this is what this world's like, maybe it's something that's not that bad. Mm-hmm. But they fail to disclose all the cold nights out in the woods that you have to experience.
As you've... No doubt. I mean, this first time, I think it's the first time possibly that I've got a guest on that's got an IMDb page, which is fun for me to find. I was like, oh, cool. I've got an IMDb page to work from. I live on that app during television shows. I've just finished Ted Lasso. So every time someone's come on, I'm like, where are you from? What else are you doing?
Yeah.
So how did you end up getting into that? You said your drama departments were woeful. Was it just good college and that was it?
It was later, like high school stuff, because eventually when they like sorted their shit out and got more teachers, it was a case of everything we were doing I enjoyed, so it was that helped. And then obviously I went to college to do acting, so it's that was the bit that really helped, like met some great people and worked from some great texts. It was where I opened up my mind to more theatre stuff, because it's the question I always get asked when I tell someone I'm an actor. It's like, are you more film or are you more stage? I was like, I was more film, but college helped open my eyes to stage, so I'm more open to it now.
I suppose with stage, especially stage, is helpful for wrestling as well.
Yeah.
Film, you could be more subtle, I suppose. You know, I'm trying to give advice of that to someone who's studied to be an actor. But yeah, film and TV is a bit more subtle, and you can be a bit more closed off. Whereas stage, you have to play to the back of the room. You have to be more expressive, I suppose, and that will no doubt help when you're trying to shout to the back of the Ardler Complex or something like that, which is a fairly sizable hall. When it comes to places that Fair City run, anyway. So from with that experience in mind, we'll probably come back to it at some point, but with that experience in mind then, when you came back to wrestling, came back to watching wrestling, was that something that you paid more attention to more, the facial expressions, the acting part of it, as well as the wrestling side of things, the athleticism side of things?
A little bit. Like, it wasn't something that, even to now, it's not something I overly analyse. Because it's something I do every like, me and my mates are the worst for watching films. We're all like basically film students. We analyze so much in films, like we're a nightmare to be in the cinema with. But when it comes to wrestling, I'm more invested in like what's going on in the match. So I try not to be the one that over analyzes it, unless I'm going back to watch something specifically for like a certain cell or something like that. I tend to try my hardest not to.
You try to be like separate churches. Yeah. You try to make sure you have your film side of your life and your wrestling side of things.
Yeah.
That makes sense. That's that bit. So yeah, back to the acting then. You know, wrestling's fine. So like I said, there are a couple films that are post production on your IMDb and things like that. So how have you found balance? Took that break, but how are you finding it now, balancing that life and your training?
It is a lot easier now. Well, I'm not at college now anyway, so it's a lot easier with that, but it's easier because I feel like I can say to because when I get booked in for a film, like, it's just happened. I just did a film shoot, and the days were like the 19th through to yesterday, and I felt comfortable enough to be like, no, I'm booked for a show on the 20th. But it's everyone on both sides are super accommodating, so I find it a lot easier to be able to say, I can't do this day, I can't do that day. I feel less pressure to like try and impress everyone, basically.
Do you feel, I don't know if this is going to be your experience, but I feel like nowadays, certainly since we're at the advent of being able to speak about your mental health and being more open to do that, that you find more places and productions and whatnot are more thoughtful, I suppose, of that. I mean, I don't know myself because I work in 9 to 5, and that's it. I don't have a exciting job like acting or being a wrestler, but I find nowadays that there is, people are more open just to go, take a break, or yes, work-life balance is important, and not so much stuck in the mud of going, no, you work for me, that's it, 5 days, you're here, night till whatever. So I don't know if you found, since your break, that is a bit more.
I definitely do feel that, because especially just for like the FCW management allowing me to just take that break from training, super accommodating with it, super lovely with it, and also like I've almost had to not be on a film shoot because I found out the dates like a week before, and I had to book days off from my actual job and obviously with a week's notice, my manager was like, I can't really do that. So I had to try and arrange everything just to check, and she had managed to actually find someone to cover my shift. So I'd swap the day of the shoot just to get, so I didn't have to take the day off. Ended up having both, so I just got a nice day off of work for a day.
Oh, not so bad. Hopefully they're not listening, so that doesn't happen again. But so what's your kind of genre then? I know as an actor you're probably gonna be open to doing any kind of role. But what's been your genre? What's the films you enjoy?
It's definitely gotta be horror. I'm a big horror fan, especially anything like slasher movie. That has my entire heart.
Okay, we're at the opposite ends of the spectrum here then. So that's so I can't even go, do you like this kind of movie? Because I don't know anything about horror. So yeah, so what's so I know things like your B movies, which is kind of your slasher fix generally, are more B movie style. So what kind of films are we talking about then for those that are listening that know about horror films?
Well, if I had to pick like a top three, it'd be Nightmare on Elm Street, Halloween, and like Evil Dead. Evil Dead is a big one.
I've heard of them, which is fine. unfortunately, the only Nightmare one I've seen is the remake. With the guy who plays Rorschach in Watchmen.
Yeah.
That's the only Nightmare I've seen. And, you know, apt name. I didn't enjoy it. So that was... Well, this turned me off the whole genre. It's just, I don't like being scared. I don't see the point of watching
Fair enough.
Scared. That's not for me. I don't understand why people watch films to cry either. It's just like... I don't get it. I'm a robot in that kind of sense. Give me a superhero. I will watch a superhero film.
Yeah,
that'll be
that's
me.
Fair enough.
So yeah, what's it about the horror then? Is it just like as a film buff, is it the case of trying to imagine how they've done the production, how they've made it look so real, or how they've done it, or just a case of it's just something a type of film you just enjoy to watch and sit back and just take it in?
I think it's a bit of both, because I love looking at something, pardon me, like horror-based, and trying to think of how did they get the right lighting for this shot? What are the shots that led up to them deciding on this one? All stuff that could, like, help me and my friends in our sort of our own filmmaking, because you mentioned at IMDb, one of them is actually... one of our own movies, Night of the Red Moon. Two of my tattoos are based around that. Got the mask that we used and then also the knife. But it's stuff like that, like especially with Evil Dead. We look at, there's a particular type of shot in basically any Sam Raimi movie where it's like a first person POV or like a really quick zoom, like in on someone's face.
Yep.
And we admittedly, like me and my friend Dorian, we love those kind of shots. We're responsible for, I think, two or three of them in our movie, and we've shown no signs of stopping. So it's a case of, I really just love a cheesy, like, low budget, quite terrible at times slasher movie, but also like the production side of it as well.
You mentioned Raimi, and then you said that, and I just thought, right. Obviously, my Raimi experience will be Spider-Man.
Obviously.
Spider-Man and Doctor Strange, Multiverse of Madness. And as soon as you said that, I could think of the moments in all those films that's had that Raimi get a zoom-in shot and things like that. So that's, I'm assuming that's possibly the dream then, is to make more slasher flicks and it'll be Bruce Campbell in the future.
I have spent an entire day on set covered in fake blood, so a step closer to being like Bruce Campbell.
Just wandering around going groovy.
Yeah.
I get the references. I've never seen the films, but I understand the references. Okay, so yeah, you've got Night of the Red Moon. I've got that one written down. I've also got Queen... Queen Janara?
Queen Ganara.
Ganara. RG.
Yeah.
And Black Chariot.
Black Chariot, yeah.
Got. So... said two of them in post production. I think Black Chariot's in pre. I think I've got.
It's kind of in both production and post. We've filmed some of it. We're going back to film some of it.
Reshoot.
At some point.
No, not reshoots. Okay.
It's not even reshoots. It's just finishing the movie. Other stuff like the movie that's been, I think, retitled again to The Reign of Queen Ganara. That was in between that. Then we worked on another project. So it was a busy last year for us.
And do you do your own stunts? I assume you do as a wrestler.
In those films, I don't get to do any stunts.
Ah, well.
In Night of the Red Moon, yes, me and my friend choreographed a fight scene, and I can't wait to do more. But in the other movies, it's all with one company, which I love to pieces. It's the one that I just did the film shoot with. But my typecast isn't the sort of one that gets into fights very often, which I really hope to change at some point.
Elsewhere from acting and wrestling, I noted you do a bit of Twitch streaming as well. So
yeah,
you're hitting the cliched stuff of a wrestler. You like horror films, acting, maybe overacting if you like a cheesy flick, and video games. So and tattoos. I think that's the general.
I've got the entire collection.
So what's the Twitch streaming about? What's just streaming about? Like I'm a 4-year-old. Like an old man here going, what do you do in the Twitch? But yeah, what made you decide to take Twitch?
It was something I did before wrestling and just gave up because I was like a bit just tired with having to keep this up. So it was only after I started wrestling again, I started doing it. Or I thought about it, I was like, well, I've got this that I can link into wrestling. So I just renamed it and started doing it again. And I've been having a lot more fun. Because it's just a case of I either pick a story-based game like I did with the Batman Arkham series and I can just do loads of episodes of just working through that. Easy games that I've played about 800 times so I can pretty much play like it's the back of my hand or do one-offs every so often just to keep it interesting. And it also gives me something fun to do because at this point when I'm playing a game I get bored within about half an hour. And just sort of have to power through.
Yeah, that's what put me off Twitch. Like, I tried it for a little bit, and that exact reason. It's like, I've started playing a game, I'm like, I can't be bothered now. I just want to do something else. I tried to do watch-alongs, but it's not so fun when, like, nobody's in the room with you. And I know that they're supposed to say, keep going, you'll build an audience. I'm like, but I can't be arsed. I'll do this. I'll do this instead. I'll speak to someone for an hour, and then just go, right, okay, cool, uploaded. I have my time has been spent well most of the time. Sometimes it's not been spent well, but you know, that's just what you have to do. But again, it was all the pandemic thing. Everyone did like one of several things, Twitch, bread making, and our podcast. And you know, you stick to at least one of them generally. And
that's true. Yeah.
You went with Twitch. I somehow stuck with podcasting and here we are. You're 300 episodes later. So back to actual wrestling, back to your journey. So you started your training. I've got a note down here. You made your debut last January, am I right? Or this January?
This January.
That serves me right for not writing a year next to January. So that was for I think was at the time it was the Academy. Wasn't that actually the Dundee and Angus Pro Wrestling?
Yeah, it was Dundee Academy of Professional Wrestling.
That's the one. So when you find out you're making your debut, you feel ready? Did you have Pretty Boy Sam McMillan character already processed in your mind? All right, okay, cool. So it was already there.
It was fully formed. I'd pitched it to Kev like the October. It was pretty much just after I came back as well. Because it was something that I kept working on throughout the break. I was like, this is kind of what I want to do. So I basically had everything in mind. Other than at the time, a concrete finishing move, because I still was up in the air about that. But yeah, I came back, I was able to pitch it all, have basic gear design, and all like name and all that, pretty much good to go.
I bet it was probably one of the most professional pitches that Kev's received as well. If you've been working on productions and trying to pitch movie ideas and stuff like that, did you have it like all set out and ready to go and just like...
No, it was more of a... I messaged him earlier in the day to be like, can I talk to you about something at training? And then I worried about it. But obviously, given the way I told him, he was worrying about it. And once I told him, he was like, could have just messaged me that. I was like, ah, yeah, but... It was something I wanted to do face to face.
Because I just imagine that now. You spent, I want to talk to you, and you spent. I mean, my wife does that. She puts I need to tell you something later, and that's my day ruined. I'm just like, I don't know what that is. And then I spent the whole day going, what did I do?
It was literally just like, If it's okay, can I talk to you about something at training? And at the time, because I was at the gym at the time, I messaged him. I saw his response. I was like, oh, I've messed that one up. I should have just told him.
But the debut was made. You had the rough idea for your gear. Was the jacket already ordered?
But pretty much from October, I ordered it. And it got to like a couple of weeks before the show. And I hadn't heard. It was meant to be ready in January. So I was like, hopefully. And then, funnily enough, I was talking to someone at training about it. I was like, hopefully I have my gear for it next day or whatever. Email comes through that it's ready. I'm like, when's it going to... I was like, oh no, it's definitely not going to be shipped in time. So I'm email, when is the estimated delivery? Oh, I'll be here by the end of the week. Oh, lovely. Never mind. Still got about a week to the show.
Did it fit? Was everything that you wanted it to be and more? Didn't have to stuff
everything
anything to try and...
No, everything was perfect. Apart from the relentless, I don't want to say bullying, but like teasing I get to this day for the fact that it's white.
Yeah, that is a bold choice as a wrestler.
It looks so good though.
It does, but unless you take care of it, it looks good for one match.
Yeah, but I've got something in the works so that I have an alternate thing.
It's not only it's white, it's red, which, you know, that's one wash away from just being pink.
Yeah. But characters still work with being pink.
True. Very pretty in pink, you know. That's a movie reference as well. Haven't seen that film either. I feel like after all these years, I've mocked wrestlers for not seeing movies, and last year or so, I realised I have not seen a lot of movies either. Sorry, Ian, I still haven't watched The Batman, even though it's now available on Prime. Is it Prime? I don't know. Don't care. Not
be something.
It. I'm not going to watch it. But anyway,
it's so good. It is.
I'm at this
granted,
point now.
Far too long, but.
That's the one thing. One thing's put me off. Yeah. The other thing is, at this point, I just feel like I'm not going to watch it. Just despite Ian. But it's a case of last time I got recommended a movie, and I think it was a jest, was Alex Webb and Morbius. And that has ruined anyone's recommendations for me forever. That's it. Alex Webb is ruined. I tell me to watch a film. I'm not watching it. That's I'll watch it eventually, my own time. Anyway, the debut. Your debut in DAPW. I'm not going to call it that other name again. How did you feel about it? You made your debut, brought a crowd. It was in the unit, or was it at Queen's Hotel?
It was Queen's.
All right, so a nice venue. A venue that you went to see your first wrestling in Dundee.
Yes.
And then about 500 yards to your right is the Queen's Hotel. So that's the Best Western, isn't it? It used to be the Best Western. I think it's the right venue. Anyway, so
I have no
idea. Okay, cool. I used to go to the wrestling in that town, that place. So you're making your debut in the same place, same city that you saw your first indie wrestling in. So how did you feel about making your debut? You had your gear. Pretty Boy Sam McMillan was a thing. It was already fully formed. How was the match?
It was the same Rumble that I've just won. But unfortunately, I did not come up very well in that one. Came out number 15, I think, was the last person there. Got a couple of eliminations. Got thrown out by Holden. I don't know what chance I stood there. But leading up to it, it's a thing with shows. It just happened at the last one. All day I'm fine. I've got my gear on behind the curtain. That's when the nerves start building up. I'm like, this is the one time I don't need you. If anything.
I've learned, again, in these chats that it seems to be, if you're not nervous before going out, then you don't want it, I suppose.
Yeah, that's something that some of my old drama teachers used to say, like before exams or whatever, which was really confusing because another drama teacher had asked us and we all said yes. And she went, there's nothing to worry about. Our other drama teacher asked us, we all went, you know what? No, we're kind of fine. And she's like, ah, well, that clearly means you don't care. I'm like, which is it? But yeah, it's the age old thing of if you feel no need to be nervous, then your heart's not fully in it, I suppose.
Yeah. And I suppose it's a battle royal as well. It's a little bit less pressure on you to be the focal point, even though you probably, I don't know, maybe tempted to try and be a bit more expressive and stand out, but you don't have that as much pressure as a battle royal.
Yeah.
And April rolls around and you're on a full main card, Fair City Wrestling Show against Luke Matthews in front of at least 100 people in the Tulloch Institute in Perth. That's probably a little bit more nerve-wracking, I guess, out of the two options.
It is. Yeah, definitely. Because at first it was meant to be Zach Dynamite.
Which is terrifying, because I've seen Zach wrestle. And,
it was leading up to it, watching all the footage, I'm like, I'm about to die. But yeah, had that whole... have that story starting, and then unfortunately he did get injured. So it was the minor panic of, oh, okay, now I've got someone else, got told who it was, and I tried looking up, there wasn't much footage in general, but we got there, we planned it, everything went well, but again, those nerves right before coming out, because at most of these shows, or at all of them so far, I have had family and friends. I think I'm more nervous going out to them than I am to people that I don't know. Because at the end of the day, when it's someone like my friends, that's, if I've impressed them, that's a victory to me. Because all my friends, oh, they get super into it, despite being like non-wrestling fans.
Yeah.
Like, pretty much every time I put a promo out, I'll check the comments, and my friend Oliver has just commented something, being like, oh, well, they stand no chance. And my promo for the last King of the Class, he was like, have they already got the measurements for your crown, or are they waiting until you've won it?
Ah, Fresley, that's the best.
I love keeping them in the dark. It's so funny, because I love watching their reaction back on footage. But
that's
feel
amazing.
Really bad. I felt really bad at the April show we're talking about, because I go out, I do my entrance. When they're there, they typically, in Cody Rhodes fashion, get the weight belt and the glasses. And I give them high fives. But I didn't notice my friend Cameron, because he wasn't in the same row as them. He was one behind. And so it came time to, like after the show, going and seeing them. I was like, I didn't actually know you were here.
Cameron.
Yeah.
But I mentioned the match and the change. Yeah, I think I remember when this match was announced, and I did see it was yourself who I hadn't seen.
Yeah.
I seen your promo. I seen some pictures of you in the promos and what have you. And then I saw you were against Zach. I was like, oh well, murder in Perth.
Yeah.
That's what's on the menu. Because he is it's amazing, because he is the nicest guy outside of wrestling. But for some reason, when he is in a ring, he is a horrible person. You know?
Yeah.
So is that one of those ones where you kind of have it on the bucket list, but in pencil? Just every so often you go, no, actually, no, I don't want.
No,
don't want that
ever
match.
Since it was announced, like obviously when it was announced, Tom, was telling me, because it was like, that was his bucket list match for years, like a singles match with Zach that he wanted to do. But it was literally just a case of hearing everyone's things and going, this is a match that I really want to happen. Started getting really excited. And then it was like, oh, okay. I saw the announcement and everything. Immediately messaged him. being like, hope you're okay, hope we can still have our match at some point. So it seems the door might still be open down the line.
We'll kind of talk about Luke then. So Luke's kind of been on and off in Fair City Wrestling a little bit, and he was kind of coming in with a brand new character, ish, as well, with the old samurai sword, which I think I may put in my review. That's a terrifying prospect of having a samurai sword, but you know, you're the one that's standing across it as he's playing it about. So he had a little bit of proof. He looked like he kind of, what's the phrase, laid it in a little bit. As your first one-on-one proper match experience of a crowd, was it as good as you hoped, as you wanted it to be, or game changer as far as the physicality was?
It was as good as I wanted it to be, because it was literally like the story we managed to create just on the night of just two guys trying to prove something was great. And there was quite a few people backstage that were impressed by the crowd reaction to me, who had like one Rumble appearance prior to this. So it was that feeling of, we go out there, lay everything in, and it was actually a really fun match. I enjoyed it a lot. And for hard hitting, like, I expect everyone to do that, because I don't like it looking weak. I hate it. Mm-hmm. Like, I was involved with someone coming into the Rumble there, and I was like, the one thing I need to make sure that you do, because if you're going to clothesline me, go right through me. And he did, and I loved it. Because if it looks good, then the crowd are happy.
Yeah. Method. All the old method acting. If I'm going to look like it's in pain, just hurt me. That's probably the best way to do it.
You'll get a good reaction if I have something to react off of, which is the hole may or may not be in my chest.
So you're speaking about Zach there and saying that you kind of got more excited with the more people that were coming at you, going, this is a match that they want to see. How, when you started with Fair City and with the APW, right, did you kind of expand to watch some of these more independent shows in Scotland? I mean, WrestleZone's probably a bit more difficult to get hold of footage for, to see more of Zach Dynamite. But but for likes of your ICW, likes of, I'm trying to think who puts out regularly, Pro 2, I suppose. I mean, there's places that will put out matches. Target was a good example. Did you expand to check out these other places, or did you kind of want to concentrate on yourself first and then
I did kind of concentrate on myself, and it was more of, one thing that I didn't want to do was watch something, especially something local, see something they're doing and go, I really like that, I'm just going to do exactly that.
Right.
Like, it's like when I started thinking of the gimmick, I wanted to just sort of base it off of early solo run Shawn Michaels. So I watched a bit of that, but I didn't want to watch too much to the point where I was doing a cosplay of Shawn Michaels, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's the acting training coming in. That's what they always tell us for a show. It's, don't watch other interpretations of it. Then you won't be doing your own idea. So I just try to watch little bits of stuff, get a little bit of inspiration. But at that point, I was too busy. Like, this is something I'm doing. I'm just going to focus on me and be able to actually do it.
And that leads us to King of the Class this year. For the APW, which is now Dundee and Angus Pro Wrestling. Patrick Patierski, he relinquished his crown. He abdicated.
He did.
And he was no longer the king of the castle. He's now on the main shows with Kieran Douglas. He's put a question about it, so I will ask about that, and then we'll ask about your thoughts of being the new king of DAPW. So he's put, congratulations, Prince Pretty Boy, but I do look forward to returning to DAPW in the future to see if I could take the King of the Class crown back from you. As for my question, who do you think has been the best king in wrestling history and why? P.S. If you answer anything other than King Booker, then we are no longer friends.
Well, obviously, number one is King Booker. It is literally the like point of this is what everyone who's won King of the Ring should be doing in terms of leaning into it so much. Like, it's almost like an entirely different personality for him.
Mm-hmm.
It's so great. But other ones that stick to my or come to mind, honestly, have to be like William Regal, and dare I say it, I quite liked King Corbin.
I thought you were going to say Lawler, to be honest, with that kind of apprehension and hesitation.
But no, King, I liked King Corbin. It was, I think I liked so much because of what we had before it, being Constable Corbin, which wasn't great, and then the presentation that they gave to him once he became king was something that actually led him in quite a good direction for a little while.
I liked his crown.
Yeah.
As positive as I'm probably gonna get about King Corbin. I like when they do lean into it. But my favourite crown of the old King of the Rings is always gonna be Sheamus. With the red like crown of thorns,
yes,
kind of thing. That was amazing. But I'm trying to think of kings of top, other than Luke King Sharp as well, probably one of the best kings in wrestling. But no, it's an interesting history of that. I mean, I see you're wearing the crown, of course, so you're all in on the King of the Class persona. Have you already got your own decree of things you want to change at Dundee and Angus Pro Wrestling? Have you got your court in order?
None that I can share right now. It's not done yet.
Well, we may find out by the time this episode goes out. We may not, because it's actually quite a quick turnaround episode. But so coming into that, your kind of redemption from last year, and you came in and won the whole thing this time. As far as a year goes, that how did you feel like you progressed during that time?
I definitely feel like there's been a lot of progression made. Like, I worry less about so much that I'm going to do. Like, I had another match in April at a DAPW showcase against Body Guy Brandon.
Oh, I heard he's terrible.
But it was literally a case of sort out a couple of things, do the rest in the ring. And about a year ago, that idea would have terrified me. But just through basically just the reps, I worry about everything in the ring so much less. And I can actually go out and just fully enjoy it.
I mean, when I watched your first match, the one with Luke Matthews, I think I did comment on, I did the review of it. I don't know if you've read it. I don't know if that's the thing that you want to try and avoid forever and let people that actually train you tell you what's right and wrong. But I did notice that like you got in the ring and the first thing you did was slip on the second rope. But you still remained steady for the rest of the match. Is that something that, well, nowadays you possibly wouldn't have, it happened, that's it done. But in that moment, was that possibly a make or break moment in your brain, whether you're prepared for that match itself?
Wasn't even like preparedness. It was just I momentarily forgot I had kick pad covers on, that I hadn't done that sort of movement with. So I went to move too fast, just sort of slipped. So it was another thing of slow down.
Mm-hmm.
Which is one of the best pieces of advice I've been given by so many people. It's just to slow down and try and enjoy it. So from there, I just try and just
let the moments
be
breathe
in the moment. Yeah,
because we need to like clap at stuff. That's fans need. So if you do everything so quick, we've got nothing to clap for. We just go, oh, okay, cool. That's that finished. Well done. Anyway, right, got more questions, so we'll dive into those. We've got Tom Atlas asking, how did your first lariat feel, boyo?
I know the answer he's fishing for here. We had a training match back in about November where he hits me with the most gruesome sounding lariat. And it's a clip that both of us have admitted we go back and look at so many times. And the thing I love most about it is just for a second you see me just like hand to chest, make sure it's still there. Just because of the feeling of it and the sound, I'm like, oh, okay, yeah. But great way of getting into the business. Because, I mean, hit hard. If you get hit hard, it teaches you this is what you should do.
Mm-hmm. Fair. I'm just imagining now Tom in the fridge watching that clip over and over again, just to try and get some heat going.
Yeah.
We've got Be Good V Good on Instagram asking, all hail King of the Class, who are the top five prettiest wrestlers in FCW?
Top five, that's quite difficult. That's a lot of people I have to sort through.
Slim pickings.
I think, yeah, I have to put both Not Safe for Mums in there. So that's two.
Are they equal or?
They're equal, yeah, yeah. Okay. I don't want to cause any infighting between them. Christ. This actually makes me have to rack my mind and be like, who is on our roster?
There's like a huddle of FCW wrestlers right now, like furious you have not named them yet. Retro Randy, you know, the old Silver Fox himself.
I mean, I'll give a bit. Honestly, I'd much rather rank like. Why didn't they ask about prettiest gears? That's so much easier. It's the same three.
that's the next question I'm going to throw into you then. I'm checking the rosters. Caleb's number one. There you go. That's an easy one for me.
Okay, yeah, Caleb.
Caleb's there. Yeah.
I just need one more. Throw in. Let's throw in Asher then.
All right, there, Serena Rose is furious. there you go then. So, Caleb, then I lingered way too long in that pause. So, Caleb, Not Safe for Mums, Asher, I've forgotten the last one.
Let's just, actually, I'm going to throw it to Ryan Rude.
Oh, Ryan Rude, rest in peace. In FCW, still alive. Just in case.
He watches this, he's like, wait, what?
Because they're going, am I a ghost? And prettiest gears then. Alright, throw us the prettiest gears. I mean, Randy was the other name.
Randy and Not Safe for Mums. Definite three. I really, really like, it's going to sound like the same list, but I really, really like Asher's Ardor Mania gear. The red with the red. Zebra print. And then the zebra print knee pad covers. Absolutely love it. And I think I like Foundation of the Future's gear just because it's so simple. It's just nice, and the color scheme is really good.
The black and gold,
yeah,
just two tone. Speaking of Not Safe for Mums, how many times have you watched Tayport State of Mind?
Only twice.
Shocking. That's
technically once and a half, but
how did the half end?
I have a terrible attention span, so I was doing something and I clicked on it to see what it was, and I went, ah, this is what it is. This is for something when I'm in the right state of mind to watch it.
Tayport state of mind, so to speak.
I knew you were going to say that.
I know. Like I say, I'm predictable. The last question I've got on here is from Tom Atlas again. He's put top three DAPW dream matches.
for now. I don't know if I'm allowed to say Asher. He's technically on, he's doing main show stuff now, tag champion, but I'm still going to say that. So Asher, I'll say J Robin, but for the title.
Of course.
And he's fishing for it again. He's fishing for me to say him.
Honestly, Tom, you're terrible. Yeah. You just want to get put over.
I know.
I think it's probably his one chance of getting put over, to be honest. Yeah. Everyone else likes to just mock Tom relentlessly. From a place of love.
Tom, unfortunately, I can't see you. Not until you're back from injury. So I will say either Phantasm or Jaden Riley.
These two names I've not heard, but I'm already on board with Phantasm.
Yeah. Jaden is one of our very promising trainees. I've seen pretty much his entire journey and all the hard work he's been putting in, and I'd love to be able to have a match with him.
So, speaking of dream matches, then we'll throw out a little bit further afield. I think I could probably guess what your dream match out of, if everyone, will probably be your Seth Rollins, likes your Finn Balor, who mentioned at the start. But as far as the UK, is there anyone that you've particularly had your eye on that you think you could probably, maybe not at this stage, but definitely work towards having a dream match, so to speak?
I can only really think local for that. It's either Ian Ambrose or finally get the Zach Dynamite match. Those are like the dreams for now.
Get the one that was taken away and the one that started it all for you.
Yeah, basically.
I mean, as far as like, would you throw a stipulation in there? I've got a feeling because of the ladder would be involved somewhere if you had your way.
I do have a couple of stipulations I'd like a basic no DQ, a ladder, or a steel cage would all do fine for me. It's something that we talk about. Well, I've heard talked about training. Is like, what is your dream stipulations? And there's some people that throw out like an Ultimate X or something like that. I'm very basic with it. I just want to have certain sort of matches that I can just go back to normal one-on-one, or maybe just tag matches where I stay on the apron or whatever.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm still hoping that First City Wrestling finally book that Kennel from Hell match. Give me a Kennel from Hell. Needs to be brought back one day. But we're getting the Hardler. It's got a high enough roof. Just get the cage and the dogs right. Get everyone to bring their dogs. Just for the. I'm talking about a match that is way older than yourself.
I still.
Have 99.
Yeah, I won't do that. I'll do a Punjabi prison though. I'll compromise with you.
Oh, that's a tall. I mean, who would you? No, that's good. No, and the answer I say now, who you're going to face in a Punjabi prison, is not going to reflect well on me or anything that I can. It's going to end up being a little bit like, why have you said him? Because he's no. Anyway, reel myself back in. Anyway, so yeah, so you're still kind of local. You're concentrating yourself more than casting your net afield and checking out what else is happening around. So, you mentioned kind of dream matches that you've got going, and again, it's all like locally based. But
yeah,
just humor me then. Who is the dream match? Is it Balor? Is it Rollins? Who's is there any surprises that could be?
Maybe either those two or Orange Cassidy.
That is possibly the opposite of that. So yeah, why Cassidy? I mean, an AEW guy, or have you watched Cassidy stuff on YouTube? What's the appeal to him?
I don't know. It's just the way like the matches are structured. Like, it's just, oh, this is easy opponent. Go for something. It shifts into like a gear that's three up from that or whatever. And it's just something I'd love to have a, just someone I'd love to have a match with. And on that, I've just remembered another one. Just because of the stuff I've seen on YouTube from him and that, just Danhausen, because he's so different. And he's so much fun to watch. So I imagine having a match with him would also just be so much fun.
So, of those four opponents, then you've got the two that would test you physically, being Balor and Rollins, but Danhausen and Orange Cassidy that would test you almost mentally, of trying to make sure everything was targeted towards the audience as well. So that's a curious, that's a varied choice to go with it. That never say never in wrestling nowadays. You've seen people that could be on. The being released from WWE any minute or AEW, and I mean, wrestling nowadays is it's there's nothing's impossible for
No,
your
yeah.
dreams. You could be, who knows, next year you may have caught the eye of somebody and you're in an AEW ring. That's the madness that is wrestling nowadays. So before we kind of wrap up, we're the show's coming up, but I don't want to get all muddled up with the timeline and stuff like that, all the old timey-wimey stuff of me releasing something and then something happening. Because more likely, you're probably gonna you may win a title over the weekend. This episode will come out after it. Very awkward for everyone involved. Because I've got the Ryan Rude one, the Ryan Rude chat recorded
Yeah.
before his match, and then he's lost the belt, and then we talk about him being a tag team and how long is the title reign going to be, and it's going to be very weird to for everyone to watch, knowing that
Yeah.
he got jumped and abducted by Red Gate and. At the interim between that time. But yeah, where can people find out more about Sam McMillan, about Pretty Boy Sam McMillan, and all that good stuff, and plug everything, plug all your stuff.
Okay, Facebook, just Pretty Boy Sam McMillan. Instagram, I think that's just Pretty Boy McMillan. I'll need to 2 seconds to double check. It's always the
Oh.
one that trips me up. Yeah, Pretty Boy McMillan on Instagram, and then Twitch is Pretty Boy Plays.
There we go. Nice and easy. Perfect. Well, thank you very
Yep.
much for taking the time to speak to me today. I'm
No
glad that
problem.
we got this in the books, and finally Patrick Potierski
Could be happy.
can stand down. I'm working through the rest of his list slowly. We'll eventually get everyone. Not that I don't like, but I don't like getting people there on the SW podcast initially. I like to leave a big gap because you've done the FCW podcast, so Patrick and Karen are able to get loads of info out of you, so then you come to me and I ask some of the same questions, and then
Yeah, no point having it be like, we've just recorded this. How about this one? Same questions.
exactly. So I'm getting through your list, Patrick. Don't you worry. I've got some goodness for you coming up. But in the meantime, I've ticked off Pretty Boy Sam McMillan. Before we finally go, we've done the social medias. Is there any tips for other people that want to be as pretty? As Pretty Boy Sam McMillan.
Skincare. Lots of good skincare, and make sure you look after your hair. I
And if you want to do that, go to manscaped.com. Oh, what's this
boom.
code? Manscaped.com, SWN20. Use that code, get 20% off.
There it
Wonderful.
is.
There we go. That's the money shot.
You're
That's
welcome.
the ender. Thank you very much. Thank you.